Me and White Supremacy by Layla F. Saad. Welcome to my channel. My name is Samuel and I want to make self-growth normal. If you want to make self-growth normal, because I don't want to do it alone, then make sure to smash that like button. Quick disclaimer, if I say anything in this book review that comes off as racist or offensive, let me know in the comments below. You guys know if you've seen my other videos that I'm very serious about feedback regarding this stuff. I want to improve with it. People who saw the last three of my videos, and at least many others, might be wondering, oh gosh, Sam, do we have to do another book about racism? Why can't we all just be one big happy family? I thought you were a business self-development and technology book reviewer. What does race have to do with these things? Well, I make these videos because I want to make self-growth normal, but how has racism gotten in the way of self-growth becoming normal? How has racism been made worse by our use of technology? Big questions, probably a little bit bigger than this book was written to address specifically, but this might be my last racism book for a little, some time. The primary force that drives this author, it's the desire to become a better ancestor. Her purpose is to create change, facilitate healing, and seek new possibilities for those who come after she's gone. This book is a contribution to that. That, and giving that like button just a gentle little smash, because once you do, your haters take a step back and the light shines on you. The audiobook, like many others I've reviewed, is part education and part activation. It helps you take a clear look at many facets of white supremacy aspects and how they occur in different ways in you and others. Because I was surprised, even after listening to three other books about about the whole topic. A lot of people just don't think racism is here anymore. This is, in fact, not the case. I think Robin DiAngelo calls this racial framing, where racism has become more subtle and difficult to detect and see. I think there was a Kanye line somewhere, racism is still alive, they just be concealing it. Overwhelming, intimidating, and unrewarding work at first to see and do something about where white supremacy lies in your everyday life. But if you believe in love, justice, integrity, and equality for all people, then you know this work is just, it's simply not negotiable and it is worth it. The author begins by explaining, this is very common with these books, where she's coming from. That her childhood as a black Muslim girl in a predominantly white Christian society has negatively influenced her self-development, and then to, her time as an adult, where she works on the internet, she is exposed to white supremacy on, literally a daily basis. She explains who this work is for and why they need this work. To think that all of us, though, and by all of us, I mean, by us, I mean, of course, white people, to think that we all have a little bit of white supremacy in us is, you simply can't hear that and not feel some type of way about it, right? There are these journal-like writing prompts throughout the book that challenge you to really understand it. But what I'm wondering after this book, and before listening to the book, is how? What needs to be said for other people of privilege to get a book like this and do these exercises? In the beginning of my review of 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey, I had a whole rant about why I primarily think self-growth is not normal. It's because it's boring, it's unsexy, it is not easy to sell effectively. And I'm gonna be super honest, I kind of think anti-racism, it's not either. The best things in the universe, they are boring, but once you take a dive, it's like a whole rabbit hole. Let's just face the facts as human beings. We love doing what we do when we love what is in it for us. The book is a 28-day challenge, and every day is a chapter or part, component, piece, thing. But 28 days, that's a lot of days. Should we flip through and examine all those days, my thoughts and learnings as I listen to the book? Yeah, let's do that. Come on, you know what I mean? Let's do it. I'm also gonna do the challenge, by the way, after this video is uploaded. Day one is white privilege. Here it's explained how white privilege is not a myth. It is a thing. It is a real thing that is not fake. It's a thing that is real. Day two is white fragility. Are there actually 28 different, concepts that she highlights about racism throughout this book? Day three is tone policing. This is is all just like another set of ways racism has become subtle, not easy to see. Why do I feel like I did some tone policing in the last like three videos? This is why we need books like this though. Like, I swear, this is not obvious to many, many of us white people, how we are saying and what we are saying or not saying that is making things worse. Day four is white silence, where, you know, maybe it's self-explanatory. Day five is white superiority. This one's an interesting one. I mean, all of these, to be honest, are really interesting. White exceptionalism is day six. When you hear white this and white that, you may very, very subconsciously, maybe, you might think, is all of this just like blaming white people for everything? Hey man, let's not tone police here. Something that helps me is reminding myself this country was started by slave owners. Everything wrong with that and everything that has occurred, you know, before and after that in America's history, let alone history, is what we're addressing here. So instead of that, let's start focusing on what we haven't tried or thought of. Day seven is just a week one review. This might be my favorite book I reviewed so far on racism because it moves so much. It takes like all of the concepts from your head and it brings it down to your heart. Day eight is colorblindness. I have heard about this, where parents get offended if a kid says, "Oh my gosh, mom, look, it's a black man." How are you supposed to refer to them? If not that, like, what's wrong with saying black man? Is there something wrong with a black man? Teaching kids not to see race is not how eliminating white supremacy works. And I had to listen to more than one book to learn this and understand it. Day nine is you and anti-blackness against women. I love chapters like these because this just, it's just like a nook, it's a cranny that just is not addressed commonly. Authors typically will just go the on these topics in unique ways too. Same thing with day, what was it, 10? You and anti-blackness against men. Different ways black men are harbored against that don't just involve, you know, crime and police and law, but also sexual conquest, fetishization of financial success. It's things like that that we're quick to overlook nowadays. Day 11 is you and anti-blackness against children. This is important because all black men and women, hopefully at least, started out as, you know, black children. Day 12 is you and racist stereotypes. I think a thing that a lot of these books are kind of trying to tell us, we may be a white supremacist society and not even know it, and that does mean a lot of things, but one of those things is that white people, we might actually have more power to change that than we think. A lot of us, for whatever reasons, feel like there's nothing we can do, so we sit on the sidelines. I think the biggest reason is probably white fragility. Day 13 is cultural appropriation. I found this one quite colorful. I only mean that really in the sense of like how many different examples of cultural appropriation and how it applies that she uses. Day 14 is a review of week two. Day 15 is you and white apathy. White apathy, the choice to stay in white supremacy and the privileges it affords. A good example of this is women who came to the Women's March after Trump's inauguration and then didn't go to the Black Lives Matter protests. Day 16 is smashing that like button in case you haven't already, when a feature with mainly white people is for mainly everyone. Meanwhile, a feature with mainly BIPOC is for mainly BIPOC audiences. When I first heard the term BIPOC, I was like, what is a BIPOC? Is that like a term for people who wear bifocals? As it turns out, it's a term for black and indigenous people of color. Right, I'm just saying this because you hear the term so many times throughout the book, and if you don't understand that, you just think it's like some, I don't even know. Lack of white centering is a huge reason I love shows like Grey's Anatomy, because it's like, here, this is what it looks like when race and gender and sexual orientation have absolutely nothing to do with different social dynamics and ranks of hierarchy. Day 17 is you and tokenism. If I haven't said this yet, the book tells you so many different ways that we are racist without even realizing it. Like, I listened to this and I was like, there's terminology for all of this. I had no idea. Day 18 is white saviorism. This one is just like super compelling, where we provide for a person of color in a self-serving manner, a way that makes us feel like, you know, in later conversations, I'm gonna be able to say, I did this, I'm not racist. How could you say such a thing? If that's why you're doing it, you, or actually we, might not even realize it. Again, that's just another way that racism has become so subtle. Day 19 is optical allyship. These all sound like so like technical, but when you listen to the book, they're really not that complicated. This is like jumping into activism without education and reflection on personal racism. Reposting things like how many people just posted a picture of the whole Blackout Tuesday on Instagram just to say, you know, I'm an ally of this. Not realizing probably the main reason you're doing it is to just assuage white guilt. Day 20 is being called out or called in. This is just 20, and when you get to this point, you might be surprised, maybe not, to find there really are this many ways that white supremacy is upheld in modern first world countries. It's like when I found out that there are 237 reasons why women have sex. Day 21 is the week 3 review, and day 22 is white feminism. The author, as a feminist, had to include this. White feminism, or mainstream feminism. When I heard about feminism, you know, when I was younger, little do I know what I considered feminism at the time was really just mainstream feminism. It greatly ignores intersectionality. By side note, by the way. And this is important. What I'm wondering here is, like, does it matter whether a black person is educated about different aspects of white supremacy? I'm just asking because I don't know if this is tone policing or not, but what if black people genuinely believe, you know, there are no colors, people are people, that's all that matters, or they endorse cultural appropriation, or unknowingly agree with the use of white saviorism. Does this matter? Does it happen? Let me know in the comments below if you guys have anything to say about that. Day 3 is you and white leaders. This one is like a huge reason I decided to even do these reviews. I and my viewers, I'm convinced, have a duty, an obligation. The world is calling us for us to do something about this. A personal hero of mine, Jeff Bezos, is taking this very seriously. All over Amazon, you're seeing that they stand in solidarity with the black community. They just dropped $10 million on organizations supporting social justice and black communities. And what really strikes me about this is that Jeff Bezos says he's happy to lose customers who don't agree with this. If you know a thing or two about Jeff Bezos and how seriously he takes customer centricity, you know this is a big, big deal. Day, what was it, 24. You and your friends. Me and what friends? My girlfriend's probably the only, like, friend who I spend time with at the moment. She went to a protest last week, though. I regret not going, but I also don't regret working on my review of White Fragility by Robin DiAngelo. Day 25 is you and your family. Book really does make you think. Like, just writing out the questions for the journal, the prompts, I was like, dude, this is a roadmap. Day 26 is you and your values. If you want to know more about values, a good place to start is Subtle Art and Everything by Mark Manson, at least in my experience. Day 27 is you and losing privilege. Here she gives a bunch of different ways to practice losing privilege in order to bring access to those who don't have privilege. Day 28 is you and your commitments, and she goes over some things to kind of keep in mind as you move forward with this one. I feel like I just went over so many different things. So as far as my overall thoughts on the book, all I can say that I haven't already is that I'm very excited to work on these journal prompts in the next 28 days. Quotes. Here's to doing what is right, not what is easy. When you insist that BIPOC talk about their experiences with racism without expressing any pain, rage, or grief, you are asking them to dehumanize themselves. Just because a stereotype seems positive does not mean it is not harmful. Our humanity is worth a little discomfort. It's actually worth a lot of discomfort. Direction 1. Whenever there's a direction 1 from the author, I always have to say it in my reviews. The author says that this book is for people who hold white privilege. So, pretty much white people. And simply put, I agree. Direction 2. If you like this book, you might want to check out White Fragility by Robin DiAngelo and So You Want to Talk About Race by Ijeoma Oluo. Me and White Supremacy by Layla F. Saad. There's a link in the description if you guys want to check it out and read the reviews. That and all the other books that I mentioned in this video, if you want to check those out too. If there are any other books that you guys want me to check out and review, please let me know in the comments below. Also, let me know if you checked out this book and you liked it. But hey, make sure to smash that like button, subscribe if you haven't already, because I don't get why people watch this far into my videos and they don't subscribe. But if you have subscribed and you want to turn it up a notch and turn on that notification bell to get a notification whenever I drop a new video, that would mean the world to me. Thank you guys so much for watching. I really appreciate it. You can find me everywhere and I will see you then.